ก่อนสื่อสารใดๆนะคะยังไงช่วยขอความกรุณาช่วยปิดField of mass spectroscopy, shared the Nobel Prize in the year 2002. Professor Woodrick received the Nobel Prize, and I quote, for his development of nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy for determining the three-dimensional structure of biological macromolecules in solution, unquote. TISTER and Science Museum share this exciting event in giving you this great opportunity to be in this exciting lecture. And now I would like to invite Mr. Prabhat Podiwarakun, President of TISTER Board of Committee, to give an opening remarks for this lecture. Mr. Prabhat.
Mr. Woodrick, Mr. Moravitz, President of International Peace Foundation, Dr. Manoon, Inspector General, Dr. Nublak, Governor of TC, Mr. Supachai, Deputy Director of NSM, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It is a great pleasure of Thailand Institute of Scientific and Technology Research, in cooperation with the National Science Museum, to heartily welcome the year 2002 Nobel Laureate in Chemistry, Professor Kurt Woodrick. In addition, I would like to acknowledge the kind support of the Ministry of Science and Technology in making this event possible. It is indeed a privilege for Thailand to be selected as one of the countries to welcome and host several Nobel Laureates in different areas of expertise, so that we can have chances to experience their knowledge and views given by internationally respected experts. This will undoubtedly inspire Thai researchers to pursue their professional goals. In this connection, the topic of the lecture, NMR studies of the structures and functional of biological micromolecules, would be highly technical as well as significantly beneficial. The valuable body of the knowledge to be gained this afternoon is expected to apply to various areas of science research, namely medicine and material science. Last but not least, I wish you all the best in your deliberation and your effort to advance scientific and technological goals. The auspicious moment has now arrived. I now declare to open up this honorary lecture. May this event meet with every success as intended. Thank you very much.
It is a personal honor to me to be a master of ceremonies for this particular lecture, as my PhD thesis also involves structural biology. Unfortunately, it was in protein crystallography. So therefore today, we hope that Professor Woodrick would enlighten us on how to use NMR to obtain protein structure and not having to go through the ordeal of obtaining protein crystals. Just before we begin, I would like to give a brief introduction on Professor Woodrick. Professor Woodrick was born in 1938 in Aarberg, Switzerland. He has completed his PhD in organic chemistry in 1964 at the University of Basel, Switzerland. Since 1980, he's been a professor of molecular biophysics at ETH, or the Federal of Technical Universities in Zurich, Schweiz, and visiting professor of structural biology at the Scripps Research Institute at Loyola, California, in America. And now, the moment we've been waiting for, please welcome Professor Kurt Woodrick for the lecture on NMR studies of structure and function of biological macromolecules applications in biotechnology. Professor.
Thank you. Okay, yes. No. It's... Well, I would like to thank for the kind words of introduction by a crystallographer who traditionally would not have such kind words for me. And I would also like to thank you for inviting me to visit this special place. It really comes quite as a surprise when one drives through the country and then sees the shape of the Science Museum at the distance. And the surprise gets even bigger when one comes closer and sees the rather fantastic architecture. I have prepared a talk for today which is much more technical than the talks that I have given during the week, because I had been asked to speak about the theme NMR studies of structure and function of biological macromolecules, which I understood that I was expected to explain the method that we use for the purpose of protein structure determination by NMR. So let me start, and I think the first two slides could help us to get into it. Fine. So, what I will talk to you about is the determination of protein structures at atomic resolution by NMR in solution. NMR stands for nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy, as it is spelled out here at the bottom of this slide. The important terms in this slide are that we work with three-dimensional protein structures, not just with the chemical structure of proteins. Important, we work in solution as compared to crystallographers who first have to get crystals of the proteins before they can determine the structure. And because proteins are not usually found in single crystals in nature, but they are found in body fluids or in contact with body fluids, which are all protein solutions. I mean, a body fluid would be the blood or the liquid in the stomach or anything. If you cut yourself, anything that will flow out is a body fluid, and that also is a protein solution. So of course it is of quite some interest to be able to study these molecules in the environment that they have when they perform the physiological actions, rather than take them out of this environment into crystals before studying the structure. Now you see why crystallographers don't usually like me very much. You see here two different shapes of a polypeptide chain. Here you see what I would call a random coil chain, and here you would see a folded chain. Now in the car, my companion, who doesn't understand anything of science, he says, and no chemistry at all, told me that it helps him a lot if I play with my belt during the lecture. So let me play with my belt again. So what this shows here is a chain like a belt here, okay? And this would be a denatured form of a protein. I mean, in addition to the belt, which we call the polypeptide backbone, there are also so-called amino acid side chains indicated. Now, this sort of presentation of a protein only describes the linear chemical structure, as it can be read off the DNA sequence, I mean the genome sequence, in principle. And this is not sufficient to understand how the protein functions. For this, we need to get information on the unique way in which a protein, being this linear chain or this linear belt, is folded up into a three-dimensional shape, like this, somehow into three dimensions. So we need either X-ray crystallography or NMR in solution to go from this to knowledge of this. And only this folded form of the protein will enable us to discuss intelligently how the functioning of the protein can be understood from its structure. Now, when we want to study the structure of a folded protein with NMR, then there is a very basic observation that has been made over 40 years ago, which is really at the start of any attempt to use this technique for a protein structure determination, which is that when we go from this so-called random coil or denatured chain of the protein, that is, the spectrum is shown here, you see RC that corresponds to random coil here in this drawing, and we go to a folded form, then the spectrum changes dramatically. You can see there are no lines in the NMR spectrum here, whereas there are plenty of lines when the protein is folded. The same for this part of the spectrum as well as for this part of the spectrum. And in between, we have a much larger number of lines that arise from this shape of the protein than from the denatured shape of the protein. So in other words, if we have a folded protein and we do something horrible to it, such as heating it or making the solution very acidic, and then the protein opens up, we can follow this process by just following the change in the NMR spectrum. And of course, this is also a very big advantage over crystallography, which cannot follow stepwise degradation or unfolding of a protein. Now, let me, after these very basic observations, let me go through the protocol with you that has been established in 1984 to determine three-dimensional structures of proteins with NMR. And the first structure that was solved had the name of Pussy. Pussy in German means small cat or little cat, but actually it is a full seminal proteinase inhibitor. So it is a small globular protein with about 60 amino acid residues. So what we do in the course of a structure determination is that we prepare a protein solution in water. Now in 1984, we would isolate the protein from natural sources, for example from human tissue or from tissues of other animals, or we would isolate it out of bacterial cells and similar. But anyway, we did not at the time have access to recombinant protein technology, which we have today. So this is just the first point in the protocol. What I want to indicate is in 1984 we used exclusively proteins from natural sources. Today we would primarily use proteins obtained with recombinant technology. Once we have prepared the protein solution, we would run NMR spectra. In 1984, because we isolated the proteins from natural sources, we could only use homonuclear proton NMR spectroscopy. Today, because we have access to recombinant protein technology, we can label the proteins with carbon 13 and N15, and therefore also use heteronuclear, two-dimensional, three-dimensional, four-dimensional, or higher dimensional NMR experiments. Now, what do I mean with high-dimensional NMR experiments? You see, when I have just one frequency dimension in the NMR spectrum, this is a one-dimensional NMR spectrum, and the frequency is indicated in relative numbers. Doesn't matter, it always goes from 0 to about 10 when we talk about hydrogen nuclei NMR. But you see that when we have a folded protein, then the lines tend to overlap. Here we have a few well separated lines, but here the spectrum consists of mutually overlapping lines. And that makes it difficult to analyze such a spectrum in detail. In practice, it is actually so that we can only work with a few lines here at this end, here in this region, and here, which are rather well separated from the rest. And these are only about 15 hydrogen atom resonances out of at least 500 in this spectrum. And you see also that all these lines that we can use when we work with a one-dimensional NMR spectrum occur in regions of the frequency range where there are no lines in an unfolded random coil form of the protein. Now, because of these limitations in using one-dimensional spectroscopy, Professor Ernst and myself introduced two-dimensional NMR spectroscopy Professor Ernst is also from Zurich. He also obtained the Nobel Prize in Chemistry already in 1991, and he started to work with these two-dimensional techniques already in 1974, and then from about 1976 to 82, we joined forces and developed these measurements so that they could be used for her prescribed. And the set of experiments that we had in hand by 1982 were COSY for correlated spectroscopy, NOSY for nuclear Oberhauser enhancement spectroscopy, SEXY for spin echo correlated spectroscopy, and FOXY for foldover corrected spectroscopy. And the two-dimensional spectrum then looks as it's shown on this slide. See, now instead of having just one frequency axis, I now have two frequency axes, omega 1, omega 2, each one goes from 0 to 10, 0 to 10 in the homonuclear spectrum. And now I have a much larger number of separated lines. I have the diagonal here, which would correspond to the one-dimensional spectrum. But then I also have a lot of peaks out here in the plane. And you actually don't see most of the peaks because they are very small. See, you have here an indication that there are small peaks. There are also small peaks here. And I'm now going to show you this part, which is equivalent to this part of the spectrum, in a view where I look at the spectrum from above and draw contour lines around the little mountains here. And then it looks like this. And now you see the tremendous change from working with a one-dimensional experiment to working with a two-dimensional experiment. Instead of having 20 or 30 well-separated peaks arising from a protein, I now have hundreds, or actually today thousands of peaks that I can distinguish. And just as crystallography needs a large number of diffractions in order to determine a three-dimensional structure, we also need a large number of data points in order to assign unique positions in space to all the atoms in a large molecule. So much about the second part in my protocol, the NMR spectroscopy. Again, this was a kind of spectrum that we got in 1984. Today, we would use three-dimensional and four-dimensional and also six-dimensional NMR experiments with isotope-labeled proteins to do the kind of work that we want to do. Now, what do we use the NMR data for? First, we have to get what we call sequential resonance assignments. Now, this is the following. If I again take my belt, then this belt, or which represents a polypeptide chain, contains a large number of atoms. Depending on the size of the protein, it may be 500 atoms or 800 or 7,000 atoms. So I have the job of finding out to which atom along the chain these peaks belong. That was a reasonably difficult problem to solve. And it corresponds largely to solving the phase problem in crystallography. And in crystallography, you can have 17,000 diffraction points. If you don't solve the phase problem, you can't solve a structure. We can have the most beautiful spectrum. If we are not able to get sequential resonance assignments, we cannot do a structure. Okay, so at the end of this third step in the structure determination protocol, I have established one-to-one relations between atom positions along my polypeptide chain and peak positions in the NMR spectrum. At this point, I can now start to collect those NMR data that enable the determination of the three-dimensional structure. Again, with my belt. What happens is that my belt is quite long because I'm fat. Okay? And proteins, I have also long polypeptide chains because they are big molecules, not necessarily fat, but they are big. And so the length of the polypeptide chain in a protein is at least 500 angstrom or 1000 angstrom. Angstrom is a unit that's much shorter than a centimeter. I think that's good enough if I describe it in this way. But the important point is that with NMR, I can only observe very short distances. And these I observe with so-called nuclear Oberhauser effect. This happens to be a two-dimensional nuclear Oberhauser enhancement spectrum, or NOSI spectrum. Now, after I have been able to assign these peaks to particular atoms in the chain, these peaks tell me about short distances between precisely defined atoms along the chain. Now you see, if I have a linear chain that's 500 angstrom long, and this spectrum, I mean one of these peaks, let's assume it is this one here, tells me that this end is only 5 angstroms away from that end, then I know immediately that my chain forms a circular structure. If I now pick a second peak, let's assume this one, and I now find out that this peak tells me that this position in the chain is near to this one, then I already get this structure. If I go again into the spectrum and pick this peak, and this peak tells me that this here is close to that, then I immediately, very soon, get a fold that resembles what we now know it, what we know nowadays is a kind of three-dimensional structure that we see in proteins. Now, of course, if I only play with my belt and my hands, I can manage about 5 or maybe 6 points. Then I don't have any fingers anymore to play around with my belt. And therefore, I now have to go to the computer, and I need theoretical physicists and computer engineers who will build fast computers and write algorithms and software that enables me to do that job which I have shown to you with my belt and my hands in a professional fashion. Today we read the protein spectrum into a computer, and within half a day the computer spits out the structure. That's a big change. It used to take 6 months until a year ago. Now we just read this into the computer and out comes the structure. And this would be three-dimensional structure determination by distance geometry. So originally we used metric distance geometry. It would take about 400 hours of CPU time on the fastest computer in my not too small school in Zurich to calculate a single structure. But today, it takes about half a second to do the same calculation. At the time, we used, as I said, metric distance geometry, theory. Today we use molecular dynamics calculations in torsion angle space, and what we minimize it, which of this is just a mathematical technique, and as in 1984 we would minimize a function that would provide a fit to the measured distance constraints that we obtained from the NOE data. And what comes out is a three-dimensional structure of a protein. The green line is the backbone, and the red lines are surface side chains, the blue lines are interior side chains. See? Now this is a folded protein, like this, and then the interior is tightly packed with what we call amino acid side chains. Now it is relatively easy to check that such a structure is indeed a valid solution to the problem of finding a three-dimensional arrangement of the linear chain that satisfies all the experimental distance constraints. We can simply calculate the residual error function, and then it becomes clear whether or not that calculation has converged or not. It's a very big calculation even today, although it now goes very fast. What is much more difficult to decide is whether or not this is unique, whether or not the NMR data are sufficient to define one structure, one three-dimensional arrangement of the polypeptide chain, or whether indeed there might be other solutions. That would of course have been a disaster, and then the crystallographers would have had a big laugh. So what we did in 1984, and what is done by everybody even today, when an NMR structure is solved, one checks on the uniqueness of the structure by repeating the structure calculation with the same input data but different boundary conditions for the calculation. That sounds very intellectual, boundary conditions. What I mean is that we generate the random point shape of the polypeptide chain, we generate 10 million random point states, and then we pick 100 and start the calculation with 100 different random point states. And the result, if we are successful, looks like this. The polypeptide backbone can be nicely superimposed for the results from the different calculations. The interior blue side chains also fit nicely, and on the surface we have a mess. So wherever we have a tight fit of a bundle of 10 or 20 such calculated structures, we know that we have a precise definition of the structure. And usually this part also fits very well with the crystal structure if most methods have been used. I mean, here for this protein we would have a root mean square distance of about half an angstrom between the crystal structure and the NMR structure of the green and blue parts. But because we work in solution, the surface of the protein is distorted. And therefore, our friends, the crystallographers, tend to say we cannot solve the structure with as much precision as they can. I say, well, that doesn't matter, because what they see is anyway artifactual, what is on the surface. The surface is distorted in solution, and that's what matters if one wants to understand protein function. Alright, so this is the way this protocol works. There is a refinement step at the end. We just make sure that we get proper energies for the confirmations maintain proper covalent structure for the polypeptide chain and so on. Now, since 1984, a lot has happened. We have modern methods to prepare proteins. We have heteronuclear 3, 4, 5, 6 dimensional NMR. We use heteronuclear NMR for the sequential assignments, which have been at least partially automated. We do no longer collect NOE distance constraints manually. Once we obtain assignments, we have now software that automatically collects the NOE distance constraints and calculates the structure at the same time. And instead of distance geometry, we use molecular dynamics calculation in torsion angle space, always minimizing the function that is defined by the difference between the experimentally determined distance constraints and the actual distances in the state of the three-dimensional structure at a given moment during the calculation. See, because we work with protein solutions, I am always careful to keep myself liquidified inside. Otherwise, I might turn into a crystal. That would be about the worst that could happen to me. Okay. Now, there is more to NMR than just getting the three-dimensional structure. Can you go backwards here? That's new now. Great. Okay. We can get quite a lot of information on dynamic properties of the protein. Which is, a protein is not rigid in its state at room temperature. Because, room temperature or body temperature is a very high temperature relative to 0 degrees Kelvin. And so, we of course have elemental thermal motions. This means that we have small amplitude, very high frequency motions around the individual single points. All through the protein, so everything just moves with small amplitude at frequencies of 10 to the 9 to 10 to the 11 per second. This is not surprising. We have this surface disorder. We can show that transitions between the different states of the surface parts of the molecule occur also very rapidly on the nanosecond. A nanosecond is 10 to the minus 9 seconds. That's a very small number, very short time. Just as 1 angstrom is a very short distance. We're talking about fast events and short distances that the atoms travel here. But outside of this disordered surface, we see a shell of solvation water. Now, in crystallography, one also sees solvation water. But one doesn't see all the solvation water because part of the proteins touch each other in the crystal. And there is, of course, no hydration water. But there is another, even more important difference between looking at hydration waters by crystallography or by NMR, which is that we can measure the lifetime of the water molecules on the protein surface. This lifetime is very short. It's shorter than 10 to the minus 10 seconds. Now what does this mean? This means that the water molecules also undergo high-frequency thermal motions. They fluctuate all the time. And the water molecules come in towards the protein surface and they go away again. So there's constant bombardment of the protein surface with water molecules that travel in and out of the hydration sites. And because of this coupling to the solvent lattice, the surface of a protein in solution is disordered and not largely ordered as it appears when you look at the protein in a single case. There are more surprising things. When we now go into the interior of the protein, that looks nicely ordered, and where we have particularly small temperature factors for aromatic rings in the interior of the protein. NMR tells us that these rings are not at all nicely ordered and quiet. These rings constantly flip over like this. This we found already in 1975. It was a big shock to the crystallographer community. And I was referred to as Mr. Ringflip for about 5 years, from 1975 to 1980. And then I had sort of gotten used to it, that protein spreads. Because, you see, when you want to turn, when you want to turn a ring over like this, a lot of atoms have to move out of place, so they move, so otherwise the ring cannot move. In a crystal, we calculated how much energy would be needed to flip such a ring over in a rigid crystal structure. And we came up with an energy that corresponds to a nuclear power plant. I mean, a tremendous energy, because you have to destroy material here if it is. So, in reality, what happens is that all these atoms, about 100 to 200 atoms per aromatic ring, move out of the way, and then the aromatic ring flips over. And the frequencies of these flips can vary from 50 to 300 to 1700 to larger than 10 to the fourth. And in all proteins, everywhere, the rings are flipping. So all proteins, everywhere, undergo constant fluctuations. We have also observed interior hydration water. There are very few molecules of water that are left inside a folded protein. These are shown here by blue balls. Now, these blue balls are in exactly the same position in the crystal structure of this protein. But the additional information that we get by looking at these by NMR is that these water molecules simply travel across the protein. Again, with frequencies of at least 10 to the 3, this is what we can measure, but we know now that the frequencies with which these water molecules travel in and out of the protein are larger than 10 to the 5 per second. Again, the water molecule is a relatively big piece of material that travels through the protein, so the protein has to breathe in order to allow the water molecules to travel in this way. Now, these are very surprising insights into the interior of proteins, and all of these dynamic processes have not been well understood so far. One feature that has been exceedingly well understood is that, can you go backwards here? That the fact that the surface hydration water is so short-lived simply means that the dehydration of the protein surface will never be the rate-limiting step in interactions with proteins. As simple as that. We have also measured the hydration of unfolded polypeptide chains. This result is the same for unfolded polypeptide chains. It says, in a very general way, protein folding, the rate of protein folding will never be limited by the dehydration of the unfolded polypeptide chain. This is quite a strong statement, and it is true across the board. Now, when we go to the interior movements, which are much more interesting from a theoretical point of view, I must confess that nobody has come up with good explanations on how these surprising interior breathing motions in Bronte could be related to specific functional features, including myself. We are searching for these connections. Probably these measurements, even today, are 10 or more years ahead of our capability of rationalizing what these observations mean in terms of protein function. And of course, all this information can only be obtained by NMR. There is no sign in the temperature factors that the rings flip over, because the population of any but the thermodynamic equilibrium torsion angles is negligibly small, so these rotations do not affect the B factors, as you may know. This is very subtle, and it was a very big discussion for many years in the 1970s because of these data that are around. Now, because we can study NMR structures in near physiological milieu, that is, we can adjust the solution not only to be in water, but we can choose the temperature to be exactly the body temperature. We can choose the ionic strength to be physiological. Actually, the protein concentration is comparable to the total protein concentration in body fluids. And because we can work in solution in near physiological conditions, we also could add another important feature into structural biology of proteins, which is that NMR has been able to demonstrate directly that there are functionally important unfolded polypeptide chains. And I showed you here an example, which was a big success for us, because it's one of the most important proteins in differentiation in higher organisms. It's a homeodomain. And homeodomains govern the expression of individual genes in the human genome, or Drosophila genome, or mouse genome, during differentiation. What we found in the structure of the homeodomain is that the ends are disordered. You see, I have here now a bundle of 20 of my NMR structures, which superimposed beautifully here in this part of the polypeptide chain. The side chains are now not shown, but here we have a big disorder. Now it turned out that when we, not for this reason, these proteins couldn't be crystallized, of course. When we then solved the structure of this homeodomain bound to the DNA, we immediately found that now in the complex, this N-terminal tail is exceedingly well folded. What happens is that the central helix, the so-called recognition helix, fits into the major groove of the DNA, but this flexible tail reaches around the DNA double helix into the minor groove, and because of the interaction with the DNA, it then adopts a unique structure. Now, such examples have also been seen by crystallography in the meantime. But the important point is that crystallography cannot show the disordered parts of the polypeptide chain. If there is disorder in the crystal, there are no diffractions to be detected. Or, more likely, the protein will not crystallize until we cut off the disordered parts. In the meantime, this structure was determined around 1990. And in the meantime, several hundred protein structures of DNA and RNA binding proteins have been shown to be either partially or fully unstructured in the free form and to adopt unique three-dimensional structures only after interacting with the nucleic acids. Clearly, if this tail were in some way rigidly folded in the free protein, it would not be in a position to rapidly fold into the minor groove of the DNA in its biological action. By the way, if something goes wrong, this is the so-called Antennapedia homeodomain from the Drosophila fly, and if something goes wrong with the binding of this DNA to the of this homeodomain to the DNA, then the flies are born with a pair of legs on the nose, which therefore it's called Antennapedia. I mean, instead of antenna, there are feet on the nose. Very fantastic result of genetic research, which is not due to us. We only did the crystals, the NMR structure, which then helped to understand how this all comes about. Now, today, we are working in somewhat new circumstances when we use structure determination methods, be it crystallography or NMR. And these new circumstances come about because we now not only work with proteins of which the functions are well known from biochemical studies, but we have a lot of genomic information available and we can just annotate genomes, pick out individual genes, express those genes, that is, prepare the proteins that correspond to these genes, determine the structure, and then not know what to do with the structure because no function is known for this gene. 80% of the genes in the human genome do not have an associated function. And now we are expected to solve these protein structures and from the structure go on to predict what these unknown functions should be. Now, one of the most promising approaches to find new functions for genes that do yield proteins but for which no function has yet been assigned is to investigate not just new protein folds, but to go on and to study also the structures of complexes formed with this protein. An example of this would be the protein DNA complex that you have seen in the previous example of the homeodomain binding to DNA. Now, there is a problem with this. There are relatively few cases where a complex between two proteins or a protein and a piece of DNA still has a small size. Usually the size gets very large very soon. Now this has never been a big problem for crystallography. Very big structures have been solved by crystallography, especially when there is a lot of symmetry in the structures. NMR has traditionally been limited to small sizes. You see, we have here a size range from 0 to 100 kilodalton. A dalton is the mass of one hydrogen atom. And so this is just, 10 or 20 is small, 100 is big. Okay, this is 7, I think. This is 110. Okay, that's what this case says. Here you have lines which indicate how many successful NMR studies have been done. And you see, this is a few years old now, In the old days, NMR was only used here in with these small things. Now, as soon as you adapt several of these small things together, you get a big structure, and then NMR couldn't do its job anymore, and the crystallographers would laugh at us. So we had to do something about it, and I show you very briefly what we did. See, when you have a small protein like this one, you get nice spectra. Now, I'm in heteronuclear NMR, N15 proton correlation spectrum. The important thing is, there are nice separated peaks. If I go into the middle of this K to something that's half as big, this is about 43 K, kilodalton, I get an ugly spectrum with broad lines. And so we introduced a new technique, TROSY, for transverse relaxation optimized spectroscopy, and then this beam gives a nice spectrum again. You see, now I still have a big molecule, but I now again have nicely separated lines. This all depends on having studied a few equations which describe the time evolution of single transition basis operators in multi-spin systems that we work with in proteins. If I simplify this whole mess here, I get simpler equations, and these equations consist of an R. R is relaxation. If the relaxation is big, then the lines get broad. If R is small, the lines are sharp. And there is J. J describes the frequency, it's a spectral density function that accounts for the Brownian motions of the molecules in solution. If the molecule is big, the Brownian motion will be slow, and the spectral density function will be large. And then R will become large and the lines will be broad. Here I have an energy term that's modulated by the spectral density function. And this term is the difference between two quantities, a dipole-dipole coupling between nuclear spins and a chemical shift anisotropy of nuclear spins. Now these two quantities behave very differently at variable magnetic field. The dipolar coupling is independent of the magnetic field strength. I just heard that you have a 600 MHz machine in the institute that hosts this lecture. We work at 900 MHz or here. Now what happens is that when you come close to 1000, this difference between P and delta gets very small, and then even if J gets very big, R will stay small, and that's why the lines keep stay sharp, and we can work with large molecules. You see, if I plot this difference against the magnetic field, I get this curve. Actually, we have, if one makes a bit more precise calculations, the minimum moves over here, and then the lower part of the curve is flat. We have good conditions all the way from about 700 to 1200 megahertz. And I mean, for this curve, I got the patent that was relatively good. Bruker has been selling high field machines ever since, because the curve goes back up, so that if one buys a machine that's here, one won't have to buy a more expensive machine later on in the more expensive but less favorable part of the curve. So that's TROSY. And what we have now achieved at this point, when using this sort of technology, is that we have gone not only to 100K, I told you 10 is small, 100 is big. We have now this spectrum here, was encoded with a chaperone, GROW AL, bound to GROW AS. It is this structure, this is a crystal structure. We just used this molecule as a demonstration, for demonstration purposes, we are now able to run NMR spectra of very deep synthesis as a molecular weight of 870,000. So we have gone from 10,000 to 870,000, that is about a factor of 100. This is of course of some interest. We can now use, we can now complement crystal structures of very big potential receptive molecules with information on interactions of these potential receptor systems in solution, for example, for screening libraries of potential lead compounds in drug discovery projects using this methodology. The introduction of TROSI also enables us now to solve membrane protein structures in solution by NMR. Now, if membrane proteins are proteins that sit in the membrane, just for example, the cell surface membrane or the mitochondria, this is a particular protein of this type, of a beta barrel type, it's the outer membrane protein X from E. coli. And what we do, hello, in this work is that we isolate the protein in with suitable experimentation from the membrane into water-soluble micelles. These micelles, in this case, we use DHPC as the detergent. These micelles invariably have molecular weights larger than 60 to 80,000. They go up to 150 to 200,000. So again, considering that 10 is small and 100 is big, these are always big structures, and therefore no one could study these with NMR before the introduction of TROSI. Now, when we use TROSI, we get very nice spectra of this mixed micelle. Again, we have an N15 proton correlation experiment here. When we go serious and want to do a structure determination, then we need more complicated experiments where we produce magnetization on the AMI protons, transfer the magnetization to nitrogen 15, and from there to carbon atoms, to the carbon 13 atoms in the alpha carbon positions. You see, for this I need at least 4 radio frequency channels in my NMR instrument. I need a magnet which is 700, 8 or 8. Actually, we can do it with 600 megahertz quite well because you have a 600 megahertz machine. And then we drive the magnetization from protons to nitrogen 15 to carbon and back. Now, if I do this without using TROSI, I get an empty spectrum. Never mind what this is, you just see that there is nothing. If I use TROSI with this experiment, I get beautiful peaks. I gain a sensitivity about by a factor of 100. You can see here, I show the traces through these parts of the spectrum. We call these strips. They are taken from a three-dimensional spectrum. These strips are empty except for that one, that peak here, which is from a flexible glycine residue. Here we have small peaks in the absence, and we're not using TROSI. Otherwise, the traces are empty, whereas you get very beautiful spectra throughout when we use TROSI. And from this, we can determine the structure in the micelle. But this is not quite all. Because we then found that we would see NOEs not only within the protein, but also from the protein to the detergent. Because the detergent is not deuterated, it's protonated. And what actually happens, you see here now a large number of strips from a three-dimensional 15N resolved proton-proton dosis spectrum. And what you see here, white peaks and red peaks. The white peaks are NOEs between different hydrogen atoms in the protein. And these I refuse to calculate the three-dimensional fold. The red peaks are endoways between the protein surface and the surrounding lipids. And when you now look at this plot, then you see red peaks only in certain areas here in the plot. And these areas are always in the middle of the beta strands in this beta band. So that the result that comes out is that this structure is covered with the lipid end of our detergents from here to here, and up here in the loops, and down here in these loops, the protein is not covered with lipid. And this is readily rationalized by the distribution of the surface of hydrophobic and hydrophilic residues. Blue is positive charge, red is negative charge, yellow is hydrophobic. You see the whole area that's covered with the lipid ends of the detergent are correspond to strongly hydrophobic surface residues. Here you have a continuous line of charged residues that limits that area of lipid contact, and the same here. So what we have, and this is rather exciting result, it's actually an extremely exciting result. It made us jump, especially because we didn't expect this and didn't work for this. The point is that in our mice cells, the thickness of the area of the protein that's covered with the lipid phase corresponds quantitatively to the thickness of the lipid phase in the biological membrane. Although we have a completely different type of architecture in building up the mixed mice cells and establishing lipid-protein contact that we have in the biological membrane. You see, it could have been that the DHPC molecules form a ring around the protein in this fashion. But this is not the case. We have this architecture. And we actually are very sure that this is so, because we also see NOEs between the polar head group and some points along the boundary here. All the green spots here represent NOEs between the polar end of the detergent molecules and the protein surface in these boundary regions. Well, that's not quite all. There was one more step to go, because now things become economically exciting. If this area that's covered by the lipid molecules is indeed inaccessible to water-soluble reagents, then we have a situation for our reconstituted membrane protein where access is allowed only to those parts which are also accessible in the biological membrane. If that is so, we can use this kind of preparation again to study functional properties of the reconstituted membrane protein. In particular, we can investigate how such protein functions as a receptor for example, a library of potential lead compounds in a drug discovery project. Now, in order to test whether or not this part of the molecule is really inaccessible to water-soluble reagents, we added a paramagnetic metal complex to the solution of the protein. And we found out that only the red parts in this drawing are accessible for contact to this paramagnetic reagent, which has a big effect on the NMR spectrum. That's why we can see it. And so it fits beautifully. Indeed, this area is fully inaccessible to this water-soluble reagent, and both ends of the protein where the loops are is accessible. And so we can now present this system to, for example, pharmaceutical industry as a system that they can use, not necessarily the cis-particular protein, but generally a system that can be used to reconstitute membrane proteins of the beta barrel type, not only determine the structure, but also investigate functional properties of the protein. And I think I have one last slide. Then you go backwards here, great, which summarizes what I have shown in the last example that I described. We have an entirely novel architecture for the mixed micelles of this protein with detergent that has been used for reconstitution and solubilization. This architecture of the mixed micelles ensures the same type of lipid environment that the protein encounters in the biological membrane. And with these experiments, we have shown that this part of the protein is indeed inaccessible to water-soluble reagents, exactly as the protein would be inaccessible to such reagents in the biological membranes. And we have access to the ends, both ends of the protein, which would also stick out of the biological membrane. And with this is the last part of my talk. I have tried to give you a survey of how NMR spectroscopy is used to determine three-dimensional protein structures in solution. There are by now about 5,000 structures that have been solved with the protocol that I have shown early on in the talk. And then I have tried to give you an impression of how the field has developed during the last few years, mostly based on the introduction of transverse relaxation enhanced spectroscopy that now enables us to work with much larger structures than we used to, including membrane proteins. Thank you.
At your disposal of almost calling myself a crystallographer, but actually I'm not. I'm almost there. I was working as a biochemist producing the crystals for the crystallographer, so I knew the pain of how to obtain protein crystal. I personally thought that was very insightful to learn how NMR could be utilized. For me, as a novice in NMR, I understood about, let's say, 60 to 70% of it. Hopefully the rest you found it as useful as well. Right, at the moment it's question and answer time. Does anybody in the audience have any questions for Professor Woodrick?
ตอนนี้มีใครต้องการถามคำถามไหมคะถ้ามีคำถามเขียนไว้แล้วก็หรือว่าถามมีไมโครโฟนนะคะถามเป็นภาษาไทยก็ได้หรือถามภาษาอังกฤษก็ได้ค่ะถ้าเป็นภาษาไทยเดี๋ยวช่วยแปลเชิญค่ะ
I have a mic for you. This is unfair if you have to fight with me and I have an electronic device. You don't.
Thank you. Originally, I'm a biochemist. So I did wonder if we can use your technique to study the 3D structure of the protein. Let's say an enzyme, why it is binding with this substrate, you know, during the enzymatic reaction.
Well, that depends on how you prepare your sample. I mean, it is usually so that active states of the enzyme are also short-lived. And so there may not be enough time to record high-resolution NMR spectra during the moment when the reactive complex is formed. And then you have to use tricks. I mean, these are also used in crystallography. Instead of a substrate, you provide the enzyme with an inhibitor of which you have indications that it binds in a similar way as the substrate, but doesn't react. It actually blocks the enzyme, hopefully in the reactive state. And in that way, you can perhaps approach the problem. You may also be lucky and get some information from dynamic effects on the NMR spectrum. That's also, there are many ways that you can be lucky in searching for such answers, but it is usually more difficult than just going at the structure determination.
Thank you.
Anybody else for questions?
As you talk, you show your slides with the detect by the lipid protein interaction with the NMR, and have you ever been detected with the glycoprotein that interaction before?
Like?
Glycoprotein that interaction with the NMR. Have you been ever been detection with the NMR before?
We see, we convert with glycoproteins. But so carbohydrate moieties in glycoproteins are usually located on the surface in contact with salt, and they are usually not structured. So in all except two or three cases that I know of, we have not been able to give a unique characterization of the carbohydrate parts. But we have certainly studied glycosylated proteins and determined the fold of the polypeptide chain in the glycosylated protein in the presence of the carbohydrate moieties. But we would not usually be able to give more than a very qualitative characterization of the carbohydrate parts. There's a lot of work to be done.
I've got two other questions here. One is that, in case of protein insolubility in water, can you use other techniques to determine the structure of proteins, such as solid NMR spectroscopy?
If the protein is not soluble in water, it can usually not be crystallized. So we have to find ways to make it soluble. Nowadays, we would probably use a brute force approach and make a few thousand variants of the protein and test it for solubility in a high throughput pipeline in our structural genomics center. You see, good, I mean, in other words, we might add one or two residues at the end of the chains. We might exchange a particular residue somewhere in the chain in the hope of overcoming the problem that the protein is not soluble. But this is, today, this is a possibility on a large scale.
But also to dissolve it into micelles, such as DHPC that you
used. That's a last resource, of course. We would try to work with soluble proteins without adding detergent. That's a last resort.
Another question is, would it be possible to use other spectroscopic techniques such as FTIR? I'm not sure what it stands for. To do the same thing.
Fourier transform infrared spectroscopy.
Oh, yes, of course. Fourier transform
infrared spectroscopy.
Yes, that's what it means. Or do you, you know, put it, using your enemy's technique, using crystallography together with NMR?
We always use crystallography and NMR together. Even I have solved a couple of X-ray structures.
So it's, for example, like referring to the same question earlier, is that it's slightly easier to use at a binding stage to possibly get the structure from the X-ray crystallography of the protein bound with substrate to complement that of the structure from NMR. Because you said it's during the binding stage, it's very fast.
It can be, yes. But you see, if you get a stable complex with an inhibitor, then you have a chance with crystallography to study its structure as well as with NMR. By the way, this is largely routine. You see, this is a most important application of high throughput techniques, that you prepare isomorphous crystals of hundreds of complexes of the same protein with different small ligand molecules.
Another one, which is how do you determine the stereochemistry, I mean, on some carbon of peptides?
So stereochemistry is not determined by NMR, and the stereochemistry in protein crystallography is not determined by the crystallographic data either. We enforce proper stereochemistry with energy functions, because the resolution of the data that one obtains with macromolecules would not be sufficient to determine the stereochemistry. But that's not necessary, because that stereochemistry doesn't vary very much, and it is exactly known from small molecule, same crystal, direct method, crystallography.
Any other questions?
Professor, organize an NMR strategy. I wonder if it could be applied for the surface molecule which form with the multimeric proteins on the surface. Could it be applied to that way? To the multimeric formation, like a multimer of the molecule, of the protein molecule, because you just showed us just only the single molecule which intercalates on the surface. But I wonder if it can be applied to the multimeric molecule, like the molecule which form the hollow on the surface like that.
You mean to supramolecular structures consisting of many molecules?
Yeah, multimolecular.
Well, Gro-EL is such an example. I mean, the Gro-EL, Gro-ES complex consists of a total of 21 polypeptide chains. This is actually a very attractive kind of structure to be used for these studies, because before assembling the complex structure, we can express and label the individual components individually. So we have a lot of possibilities with such supramolecular systems.
But for the Gro-EL, you didn't use the strategy of using the HPC. It's the same way of essay of the OMP-A molecule. It's the same way, the strategy you use with the Gro-EL.
Now let's face it, this gets now a bit detailed. But let me try to make clear what has happened here. In the case of on pigs, the molecular weight of the protein is about 20,000. And the additional material, to see the whole mixed micelle, is about 80,000. Because there are of the order of 100 detergent molecules attached. Okay? Now, this is important to mention, because I can choose my NMR experiments in such a way that I only see the protein. So, although I have a big structure, I have to analyze the spectrum of a relatively small part of it. So I have relatively few peaks in the spectrum and I can do the job. The contribution from Drozzi is a physics one. We are able to record good spectra for a big particle that tumbles slowly in solution. Okay? Now when we work with Gruyelle, then we are dealing with almost 900,000 molecular weight, and we see all of it. Okay? Now, then we also split it up. We labeled only the Gruyelle, but not the Gruyelle. Then we see about 70,000 Daltons worth of material, and not the rest. You see, this is a sort of game. And then, on top of that, the Gruyelle has sevenfold symmetry. So again, we have a very big particle, but we are looking at the simple spectrum. See, and I would not, in the case of Gruyelle, the structure has been solved by crystallography. There's no point in us spending a lot of money on and solve that structure again. But already, by recording the spectra that I have shown, we were able to demonstrate in a most direct way that the interface between Gruyelle and Gruyelle is large parts of the interface are flexible before a substrate protein is introduced into the interior of the barrel of formed by Gruyelle. So you see, that's where the complementarity of the two methods comes in. But the goal of the two studies is an entirely different one. One, we have actually gotten a complete and almost structure determination for a membrane protein. On the other, we have obtained supplementary information to what could be read out of the crystal data. These carbohydrates are very difficult to study, and I myself have not made major contributions to carbohydrate NMR. I can only repeat what I said before. We have succeeded in getting information on the polypeptide fold in glycosylated proteins, but we have not been able to say much about the part of the molecule that consists of carbohydrate.
Any more questions,
please? Yes. Maybe two short questions. One is one that follow up the previous questions. Would it be possible to use your NMR techniques to experiment the in situ derupture of proteins due to, for example, superoxide radicals? of things in situ, that means the changing.
No, usually you cannot observe, you may be able to observe molecules in situ, but usually you cannot collect sufficient data to do a structure determination in situ. That's, you see, in the membrane, for example, the concentration of the membrane proteins is far too low to give us a chance to ever determine a three-dimensional structure. So you have to get the stuff out of the membrane and get it into a more compact form, a concentrated form, either in a crystal lattice, which is stabilized by detergent, or in soluble micelles, as I have shown, or NMR.
For the second question, the study of the transmembrane protein is very interesting. Is there any...
I didn't invent it.
Yeah. And did anyone study the other type of transmembrane protein test, such as a carrier that carrying the cation part in the membrane for the nutrients, for example?
In principle, yes. That's all I can say. We have done it. We have tried without success.
In the next generation of NMR studies, which aspect do you wish it to be improved for the breakthrough technology of NMR? I mean,
well, it is.
There are several disadvantages in these techniques as well. Yeah.
You see, so far, the development of NMR has been for studies of macromolecules has been very intimately linked to the field strengths that we have. You see, 200, 300, 500, 600, 700, 750, 800, 900 megahertz. I first heard the 220 megahertz is protein, see? Then it went up step by step. And at the same time, in parallel with the field strengths, the power of the computers would increase, the radio frequency parts would be more powerful and more reliable also. So I'm tempted, of course, to say in the future it will continue in this way, but a magnet that's higher than 900 megahertz proton frequency will be very big and very heavy and very expensive. See, this guy, what I use here for most of these experiments are already instruments with a price tag of $6 million or so. And the next higher field, say 1 gigahertz, would probably be 3 times that price. There is no machine yet. On the other hand, there is a lot of work going towards the development of micro devices that we could work with much smaller amounts. There are developments in the direction of reducing the intrinsic thermal noise in the receivers by keeping the receivers at liquid nitrogen or liquid helium temperature, and so on and so forth. And I have sort of the impression that the more important developments will be along these lines rather than going to much higher field, because it seems to me to be much more cost effective. You see, I just bought NMR machines again in the United States, and I didn't buy the highest field, because it is so much more expensive. I can turn out much more results. I bought 700 and 800, which is only one third of the price of our 900, and I can turn out much more data with those two machines. But I have a 900, of course. You see, whenever I run into troubles, I can go to the 900. That's a bit special, but then I need it because it sort of also develops the whole methodology. But you see, to really turn out data, I would go to, even today, I would go to the highest possible field. It's too expensive, not as reliable as more conventional field things.
Thank you, Professor. Sorry, I'm sorry. I understand that we've had
such a... Yes, the microphone.
Okay, all right. One last question, please. Right.
Professor, what frequency gradients or what radiations do you use for your NMR spectrography?
How do I?
What frequency range do you use for your spectrography, the NMR spectrography? What radiation?
Oh, this is usually broad, this is very broadband. Usually we have, these are radio frequencies, and we need, we usually work with relatively broadband, because we don't need narrowband irradiation with multi-dimensional NMR.
I think.
Sorry.
That's okay. That's all right. Short question. Okay, I think since we hardly usually get such a Nobel laureate to grace other scientists, that's why such a bombardment of questions have been coming through. But I think this is the last part of it. I would like to invite Prapad Waterpokinha to present just a little token of his appreciation. It would be followed by Dr. Noglath Bangerdi and Dr. Manun Arangrat. I would like to thank you, Professor Puthrick, on behalf of Tister scientists and other delegates from outside Tister and Science Museum for dedicating your time to enlighten us and inspire us by your achievements. Even you were talking about how multi-talented you are as a sportsman. So thank you. Can we just give him the last round of applause before we... Please join us for coffee, mi cafe, and for those who attend the National Science Museum, Thoti Hamsa Thai, พิพิธภัณฑ์วิทยาศาสตร์ได้ให้มีสติ๊กเกอร์ติดที่เสื้อนะคะขอกรุณาเดินชมได้ฟรีไม่ต้องเสียค่าใช้จ่ายค่ะขอบคุณมากค่ะที่กรุณาเดินทางมาและเป็นมือถือทุกคนเลยขอบคุณมากเลยค่ะ